This is a rare vintage original poster from 1912 for the American Socialist Party featuring Eugene Debs and Emil Seidel. This poster was damaged in Hurricane Ida, and you're going to see what we did to restore it today at Poster Fix. Hi, I'm Chris. Welcome to Poster Fix Studio. Today we have a very special, very rare poster, a lithograph. Take a look. From 1912.
Damaged by Hurricane Ida. A lot of mold in this one. As you can see, waterline, mold. If you've got anything like this that's been caught in a flood or got wet, dry it out right away before this mold takes hold, because this mold is like a cancer on paper, and once it turns black, there's no getting rid of it. So we're gonna soak this one on too. This one is from 1912, the year my dad was born. We're gonna let these pieces soak in the water for a few hours to get the glue nice and loose so that we can take them off the old backing, bleach them, and re-back them. The bleach will help kill the mold. This is an American communist poster created 14 years after the Russian Revolution and the success of the five-year plan. I've never seen American posters that actually celebrate communism like this. Here's another pro-communist poster for a free, happy, and prosperous America. Vote communist, really free. James W. Ford, communist candidate for vice president. And here's one last American communist poster, which is in an envelope of plastic. I see all the mold here. I want to get this off here before the poster gets worse. So the canvas is coming right off. That's good. But now this paper, what about this? The paper is very thin.
The Socialist Party of America, or SPA, was a socialist political party in the United States formed in 1901 by a merger between the three-year-old Social Democratic Party of America and disaffected elements of the Socialist Labor Party of America, which had split from the main organization in 1899. In the first decades of the 20th century, the Socialist Party drew significant support from many different groups, including trade unionists, progressive social reformers, populist farmers, and immigrants. However, it refused to form coalitions with other parties, or even to allow its members to vote for other parties. Gee, that sounds familiar. Eugene V. Debs twice won over 900,000 votes in presidential elections, 1912 and 1920, while the party also elected two representatives, dozens of state legislators, more than 100 mayors, and countless lesser officials. The party's staunch opposition to American involvement in World War I, although welcomed by many, also led to prominent defections, official repression, and vigilante persecution. The organization was further shattered by a fractional war over how to respond to the October Revolution in the Russian Republic in 1917 and the establishment of the Communist International in 1919. many members left the party in favor of the Communist Party USA.
Okay, we've got this socialist poster drying now. I want it to dry so that mold doesn't continue to spread. Mold is like a cancer on paper. Okay, it's evening now. It's about 8 o'clock. Okay, so we've got all these posters. All these political posters have been taken off their old backing with the Socialist Party candidates of 1912. This will float back over to the other side once it gets wet. It's actually just stuck there because it's wet. And this one, I'm still trying to decide whether I should bleach it or not. Bleaching would help kill this dark mold in here, but the mold seems to be still and not spreading anymore. So I'm wondering if it's worth... See, the thing is the poster's already very fragile, and if I bleach it, it may get worse. It may get more fragile and get further damage. So I'm tempted just to put it back at the way it is and do some very careful touch-up and disinfect it. Put a fungicide in the wheat paste to make sure that the mold doesn't spread anymore. That's probably what I'm going to do. So I notice I have these on a separate table, although the socialist one here is a little bit more moderate looking to me. I take a neutral attitude about what people collect. I think it's fascinating to see political posters. I've never had a collector who collects such things before, and I think it's fascinating, and it's a nice new lesson of history. So we're going to let these dry more. Some of them are dry already, but this one's got it still dry. And you'll see us bleach and move forward after this commercial break. So don't go away. The Socialist Party poster, not much different. I didn't expect the bleach would get rid of the mold that was there, but just expected it to disinfect it so it won't spread. So this is gonna get linen backed and then touched up.
Here we have a screen stretched with cotton canvas, and we're going to lay down acid-free paper with wheat paste. After endorsing Robert La Follette's presidential campaign in 1924, the party returned to independent action at the presidential level. It had modest growth in the early 30s behind presidential candidate Norman Thomas. The party's appeal was weakened by the popularity of Franklin Delano Roosevelt's New Deal. The organization and flexibility of the Communist Party under Earl Browder and a resurgent labor movement desire to support sympathetic Democratic Party politicians. A divisive and ultimately unsuccessful attempt to broaden the party by admitting followers of Leon Trotsky and Jay Lovestone caused the traditional old guard to leave and form the Social Democratic Federation. While the party was always strongly anti-fascist as well as anti-Stalinist, its opposition to American entry into World War II cost it both internal and external support. The party stopped running presidential candidates after 1956, when its nominee, Darlington Hoops, won fewer than 6,000 votes. In the party's last decades, its members, many of them prominent in the labor, peace, civil rights, and civil liberties movements, fundamentally disagreed about the socialist movement's relationship to the labor movement and the Democratic Party and about how best to advance democracy abroad. In 1970 to 1973, these strategic differences had become so acute that the Socialist Party of America changed its name to Social Democrats USA. Leaders of two of its caucuses formed separate socialist organizations, namely the Socialist Party USA and the Democratic Socialist Organizing Committee, the latter of which became a precursor to the Democratic Socialists of America. From 1901 to the onset of World War I, the Socialist Party had numerous elected officials throughout the United States. There were two Socialist members of Congress, over 70 mayors, and many state legislators and city councilors. The party was able to successfully run candidates in similar municipalities as well as big cities, winning the mayorality of Butte, Montana, with Lewis Duncan, and that of Schenectady, New York, with George R. Lunn. Its voting strength was greatest among recent Jewish, Finnish, and German immigrants, coal miners, and former populist farmers in the Midwest. Its electoral base was strongest to the west of the Mississippi River, in the states where mining, lumbering, and tenant farming prevailed. It was also able to attract support from railroad workers. Its vote shares were highest in the states of Oklahoma, Nevada, Montana, Washington, California, Idaho, Florida, Arizona, and Wisconsin, and it also attracted support in Texas, Arkansas, and Kansas. From 1900, before its formal union, to 1912, it ran Eugene V. Debs for president at each election, the best showing ever for a socialist ticket was in 1912, when Debs gained 901,551 total votes, or 6% of the popular vote. In 1920, Debs ran again, this time while imprisoned for opposing World War I, and received 913,693 votes, 3.4% of the total. Early political perspectives ranged from radical socialism to social democracy, with New York party leader Morris Hillquit and Congressman Berger on the more social democratic or right wing of the party, and radical socialists and syndicalists, including members of the Industrial Workers of the World and the party's frequent candidate Eugene Debs, on the left wing of the party. There were also agrarian, utopian-leaning radicals such as Julius Wayland of Texas, who edited the party's leading national newspaper, Appeal to Reason, along with trade unionists, Jewish, Finnish, and German immigrants, and intellectuals such as Walter Lippmann and the black activist intellectual Hubert Harrison. The party outsourced its newspapers and publications so that it would not have an internal editorial board that was a power in its own right. The result was that a handful of outside publishers dominated the published messages the party distributed and agitated for a much more radical anti-capitalistic revolutionary message the party itself tolerated. The Appeal to Reason newspaper thus became part of its radical left wing, as did the Charles H. Kerr Publishing Company of Chicago, which produced over half of the pamphlets and books that were sold at party meetings. And you can read more about this on Wikipedia. I've basically had enough. After having rolled out this poster onto the linen backing with a roller that you just saw me do, I'm taking some sponges and cleaning off the face of it to make sure it's good and clean. I'm finding that there's old touch-up, old paint restoration on this poster done in the past. The reds are obviously faded and will have to be punched up later on by my wife, the great touch-up artist, Oki. And I'm happy to report that even though dark black mold, like you see over Deb's face, is like a cancer for paper, it just gets worse and worse. This paper is not as deteriorated as I had feared. It's not breaking apart because of the mold. Thank goodness. Now I'm finding a few stray air pockets, and once I roll that out, we will be pretty much finished with the rollout. The paper on this poster is very fragile. It's been put through treatments before. The paper doesn't actually want to stretch out as much as I would like it to. And I've got to be careful that while I clean it with the sponge, I don't lift the paper up or cause any further damage to its face. So now we're going to let this poster dry for a few days before we commence with the restoration. So don't go away. We'll be right back and you'll see all that. We're back at PosterFix and my wife is about to put in paper pulp, a mixture of acid-free paper powder and methyl cellulose, which will act as the filler for where there is paper missing.
There's a restore tape I glued with it.
You took it off?
Almost glued.
Okay.
It has a restoration already.
I know, it has a lot of old painting on it in the middle. Oh yeah? This one is all painted, see? And see the old red?
Yeah.
Touch up, but you or me are gonna paint the red completely again. We have been letting the screen dry. It's been a couple days. My wife has done the paper fills, and now we're going to cut it down. This has a lot of old touch-up on it, you know that, right?
Yeah.
I think we're going to have to repaint the red
everywhere. What?
We're going to have to repaint the red everywhere, all the red letters.
You should have matched with this.
This is the most complicated of all the posters to restore.
More about the Socialist Party of the 30s. In addition to the raw struggle for control of the party's apparatus, there was also a divergence of visions about the role of the Socialist Party in the then-current crisis of capitalism, with mass unemployment at home and the growth of fascism and militarism abroad. The alternative vision of the militants would be expressed at the subsequent convention of the party held in Detroit in June of 1934, at which it was Norman Thomas and his tactical allies of the militant faction which would emerge triumphant. It was this gathering which adopted a new declaration of principles, which inflamed the Old Guard faction on a number of different levels. The ideological differences between the radical pacifist Thomas and his allies of the militant faction on the one hand, and the Old Guard faction on the other, have been succinctly summarized as follows. The Old Guard was convinced that the 1934 Declaration of Principles was an open declaration in favor of armed insurrection. Thomas believed it was a necessary statement to indicate that socialists would not lie down in the face of fascism. The old guard believed that the anti-war sections of the Declaration of Principles placed the party under the threat of legal prosecution for advocating unlawful actions to oppose war. Again, Thomas believed that a strong statement was necessary to put capitalism on warning that if it engaged in imperialist war, there would be opposition. The old guard believed that a united front with the communists was immoral and would be disastrous for the socialists. That even limited united action on specific causes should be banned, and even that exploratory discussions about a united front were going too far. Thomas opposed a united front on a general level, including any joint actions in political contests. Symptoms of a new dangerous spirit among the socialist youth began to become manifest on all sides. The youngsters appeared at meetings of the party in blue shirts and red ties. At first, this attracted no special attention, for oddity in dress is no novelty among radicals. But gradually their number increased, and we now could see that this was a uniform. The socialist youth of America, like the fascist youth of Europe, had succumbed to the shirt mania. The shirt tendency was followed by the salute mania. In Europe, the Nazi salute was the outstretched arm. Here in America, the united front was symbolized by the adoption of the communist clenched fist salute. This greeting, a raised arm at a slightly different angle from the Nazi or communist salute, now became routine at all meetings. Some of the older members of the party were truly horrified at this totalitarian tendency, but others couldn't resist the trend and fell into line. Among these was Norman Thomas. Along with the blue shirts, the red ties, the clenched fists, the raised arm salute, came the banners, the slogans, the demonstrations, all the trappings that make for totalitarian, unthinking mass fervor. These now became regular features at socialist party gatherings. The howl of triumph that rose from these young people at one of the meetings, when for the first time Norman Thomas returned the clenched fist salute to them. As I stood by his side, my arms deliberately folded to indicate that I would have no part of this, which is what Lewis Waldman recounted in his memoirs. Their cheers for Thomas rose to almost uncontrollable frenzy. The Declaration of Principles does not stand by itself in a vacuum, as it were. Important as it is, it does not alone account for the vital struggle that is now being waged in the party. It represents the culminating point of a deep-seated antagonism. It is like the straw that breaks or threatens to break the camel's back. The Declaration of Principles has brought to the surface divergences which are deep, antagonisms which make of our party not a coherent political organization working harmoniously for a common objective, but a battleground for strife. Oki is using water-reversible gouache, which is archival because it can be reversed with water, to touch up the letters to brighten them up. The letters, the red letters, are faded, so they need to be punched up, enhanced, to look the way it looked when it was printed. Thank you. Don't go away. We'll be right back.
I'm going to take this blue tape off from around the edge, and then I'm going to go in and restore these little bits there and there with pencil, watercolor pencil. Thank you.
this brings us to the end of another edition of Poster Fix Studio for today. Until next time, I'm Chris. Thank you very much.